Good day to you. And where are you from today, by the way? Yeah, where are you from? Where are your clothes from? I'd like you to stop this video right now. I'd like you to check the label on your shirt, your blouse, your sweater, your sweatshirt, whatever you're wearing. Check it and see what country it's made in. Okay, what did you find out? Are you from China? Is that where your shirt was made? Are you from India? Is that where your shirt was made? I can tell you that my shirt was made in China. As well as all the gadgets that I have around me, a calculator I use almost all the time, made in China. My wallet, Tommy Hilfiger, right? Very, very important and well-known American brand. No, it's not American, made in India. Yeah, this is globalization. This is the world coming closer together to communicate with each other through products, through mass media consumption, through politics, through economics. Through government associations, this is globalization. And it's the subject that we're taking on today as we take on our third class in comparative media. And we're going to consider globalization as a context for mass media. And I want to say a few words about that when we get to it. But before we get to that, I want to talk about your RSC post. I just want to remind you that a student who does well in this class is able to learn quickly from the weaknesses that they're exhibiting in their assignments. And so some of you didn't do so well on the RSC posts because you didn't really keep your eye on the ball as far as what the assignment was requiring. And so I've sent out sample RSC posts to you to help you out. And a really good student is going to study the feedback throughout the course and adjust very quickly to any weaknesses they may have. Remember, for the RSC post assignment, you are not comparing columns. You are not summarizing columns. You are not extending off the ideas in the columns, except insofar as you are taking the media that are either described overtly by the columns or implied by the columns, and you are comparing those media according to two dimensions. The first dimension being form, which is the look and the feel of the medium. And the second dimension is the content, which is the information of the medium. So if you are not using that terminology in your posts, I'm having a hard time finding where your analysis is. So please get yourself in a good position with these posts as you go forward in the class by studying the feedback and also having that assignment, the assignment guidelines in front of you every time you write an RSC post. I also want to mention that today we'll begin really the full rhythm of the course. By the time that 1 o'clock rolls around, you will have completed your first country media response post. And that's going to be the routine for the rest of the class. 1 o'clock every day, you have those two items. Of course, we have other items coming in later, the research paper, the research proposal, and graduate students have article evaluations. But if you can get into the rhythm of your RSC posts and your country media response posts, then you're going to be in a good way for the class. All right, now to turn to globalization, the larger issue that we're discussing today. Globalization is a kind of worldwide climate. It's described in the readings that are the first readings that we're reading today that are coming from my book, Comparing Media from Around the World. I want to let you know that these readings were copied from a software program and then inputted into D2L, so you will find some grammatical oddities or some noise, as we call it, some punctuation noise that's stuck in there, some random hyphens. That has to do with the way that words were converted to Microsoft Word and then PDF and back. And I'm just not able to go and correct all of those mistakes, so please don't assume that's my writing in all areas. And I want you to get the basic information. Once again, this information is coming from my book, Comparing Media from Around the World. And you can see that in each chapter, if you read the book, I start out with theoretical information about the elements that make up a media system, the same elements I spoke about yesterday, globalization being one of them, financing being another, cultural characteristics, etc. And then when you get further into the chapter, it starts to talk about specific countries. So that's the part of the reading that I have eliminated, the specific countries being talked about, because that information is out of date. So what you're reading today is the front matter of a chapter in my book. That's why it's called Chapter 2. And it's on globalization. And globalization is a worldwide climate where countries and peoples and cultures and industries and government entities and companies are coming closer together. They're coming closer together. They're exchanging products and goods. But at the same time, we're disconnected from some of the sources of those products and goods. I mean, most of you don't know where your clothes are made. Most of you have a cell phone. I'm recording on my cell phone now. And you may be totally unaware that the minerals for that cell phone are coming from an African country like Congo, where they're mining titanium and zinc and a lot of other minerals. And then the phone is being assembled maybe in China, where labor is very cheap. And then it arrives and we find it in our pocket each and every day. So there's a kind of a disconnection that goes on in globalization. Globalization, what is it spurred by? What is causing it to happen other than the world having more people and thereby people becoming into more contact with each other? Well, if you read Herman and McChesney, they talk about corporate profit making as being the main driver of globalization. The corporations are promiscuous. I use that word, that sexual metaphor, to describe corporations and especially media corporations, because in the United States, a media corporation will reach a ceiling of an audience. They will reach a certain number of people who are going to watch that show, and then nobody else is going to watch. Let's take television, for example. Let's take the show Big Bang Theory, one of the longest running, most popular TV shows, comedy shows on American television. I'm never going to watch that show. I'm never going to watch that show because I don't like the way the intellectuals are portrayed on that show. I think they're portrayed in a very stereotypical and silly, and I have to say, Hollywood way. So they're never going to get to me with that NBC show. So the ceiling in the United States for that show, as far as the number of people who will watch it, is going to be finite. So what's going to happen is distributors of that television content are going to look elsewhere. They're going to look overseas and see if they can market that show in Britain and get a television distributor to purchase that show. Or they're going to see if they can get that show to run as a second run on Netflix somewhere else. And so this is what's driving both globalization across all products and services and also globalization across media products and services. And the increased cooperation is also between companies and peoples and governments is also leading to an increased cooperation of international bodies that have a say over the way that media content is exchanged and produced and circulated around the world. Bodies like the WHO, which is a big body being talked about right now, the World Health Organization, in light of the coronavirus and whether they responded too slowly to announcing the pandemic as it was occurring in China. There are lots of regulatories across the world, the International Monetary Fund being another one, the European Union being another one. These are international quasi-government bodies that individual nations have ceded control over. For example, if you're in the European Union, if you're France, for example, one of the Europeans' mandates is that you have a limit on advertising on television. It's called the minutage limit, minutage limit. And that is a regulation that if you want to be in the European Union, you agree to abide by. And so the limitation on advertising is for reasons so that the programming doesn't become overly commercialized. It's an example of government bodies that are arising, quasi-governmental bodies that are rising up because of globalization. By the way, globalization is not a modern phenomenon. We talk about it like it's happening right now to us, but globalization goes back in a very sordid way to slavery. Slavery was one of the very first forms of globalization, where European colonial empires went to Africa and either purchased or captured slaves and then delivered them to the Caribbean as slaves, where the slaves went to work on plantations. And then the products that were yielded from those plantations, such as molasses and rum and bananas and coffee, were then unloaded to the ships and then taken back to Europe. It was also known as the slavery triangle. Like I said, it's about as sordid as a past as you can get, but it's an example of early globalization taking place. So it's not a new phenomenon. It's an old phenomenon. It's just that right now it's more accelerated, and it's more accelerated for several reasons that I'll get to in a few moments. Media scholars like myself and others, we look at the role of media in facilitating globalization, in hampering globalization, in controlling globalization. We also look at media as an outgrowth of globalization, and that's what we're doing in this chapter here. And one of the key concepts that scholars look at is the epistemology of globalization. The epistemology is how our knowledge is limited by what we access. Our knowledge is very limited. Like, what do you know about Iran? Well, you probably know that it's a scary country because of the way that Iran is covered in the news. You probably think of Iranians as being hostile to Americans. You probably think of Iran as sponsoring terrorism and fomenting conflict in places like the Middle East. But do you know Iran was once Persia, one of the greatest and earliest civilizations of the world? Do you know that Iran is responsible for inventing, among other things, wind power? And Iran, or Persia, had a major impact on the development of algebra and science in general? No, because your knowledge is limited. It's limited by the media that you're accessing. And this brings us back in a way to the term cultural myopia that I spoke about earlier, causing you to be short-sighted about other countries and other cultures due to the media that you're accessing. So we look at epistemology. And by the way, epistemology works both ways. It's not just us in the United States being duped. If you talk to people in Britain, one of our closest allies, people that have a lot in common with the United States, because a lot of our heritage comes from Britain and we share the same language, you will find that the average British person who has never been to the United States assumes that almost every American has a pickup truck and wears a cowboy hat and listens to country music and has a southern accent. And that is because they are accessing a lot of Hollywood movies. Not all Hollywood movies, I'm saying, are portraying those characteristics, but they have a limited view of Americans, and they see Americans as boisterous and loud. And okay, you can find those elements in our culture, but it's a great example of epistemology working the other way, because media are ambassadors for your country when those media are exported to people who have never visited your country. That's how they're learning about your country. And so in a sense, we are held captive by the knowledge that we're gaining, the limited knowledge that we're gaining through the media. We're held captive. We can never appreciate, for example, Persia, because we just have such a solidified image of our head of Iran being an evil country. Now let's turn to what are the factors that are leading to globalization and the spread of media around the world, such that Money Heist is a big show, such that Orange is the New Black is seen all over the world, the Netflix show about a female prison, such that music, J-Lo, Bruno Mars are heard all over the world, such as in our music arena, Justin Bieber, good example of a Canadian artist who we don't even think of as an artist, Jim Carrey, an actor, Canadian also, Drew Carey, also hosts the game show, The Price is Right, a comedian, Canadians, all Canadians. So there's a lot of globalization going on in the media. So let's talk about what the factors are that are leading to that. Well, the first factor is more international travel, at least prior to the pandemic. That's the way that things were, that people are traveling more often. And why is that? Well, for a start, airplanes are going to more airports. More airports in more places in other countries have been opened up. Also, people are able to book their own trips. They are able to jump on the web and get really cheap flights. There's all kinds of software and apps that you can get to get you places. So the travel agent and the hassle of that has been eliminated. And also because we are seeing more places in the media through films that we're watching, streaming shows that we're watching, and just general searching on the internet, as well as social media, we're more curious. And that comes to another factor later, but we want to travel. We're more open to traveling, at least some of us are, than never before. A second factor that's leading to globalization is the development of communication technologies. In the old world, a world that I grew up in, especially in broadcasting, it was a very limited world. It was a world that was limited by the really big networks. When I was a kid, if you wanted to watch TV, your choices were ABC, CBS, and NBC, and the PBS station, which always came in weaker. And that was it. Okay, well, enter into the scene the newer communication technologies at that time of cable television and satellite television. Cable television and satellite television introducing much more specialty television programming. For a time, it was called narrowcasting as a contrast to broadcasting, which is free and is over the airways. Cable, you must subscribe. Satellite, you must subscribe. But narrowcasting really never caught on. I mean, as a programmer, who wants to be programming something that you consider to be narrow? So that term was flawed from the beginning. But the point still holds that cable, with its specialty programming, you can watch. If you love golf, there's a whole channel just for golf. If you're really into weather, you can just watch weather. If you're really into politics, you've got conservative politics with Fox, you've got liberal politics with MSNBC, you've got down the middle of the road politics with CNN. Some of you won't consider that statement to be that true, but generally speaking, if you put those three together, that's how they stand in relation to each other. And so there's the ability today to focus very specifically on what you're interested in and not just leave it up to the NBCs and the CBSs to serve up what they're going to serve up and then you have to watch. And a lot of the shows, at least on television, are more internationally oriented. You have shows like Survivor that take places in other countries, or Anthony Bourdain, before he passed away from suicide, was doing that Parts Unknown series where he was going all over the world and cooking with local people. So communication technologies, not just in television, also in radio, that we don't have that many foreign songs that we're listening to here in the United States. Music is still circulating all over the world because of the technologies of sending MP3 files over the internet. Very easy to do. You don't have to pop a CD in the mail and send it abroad anymore. Communication technologies. And then there's just the flat out internet. You can jump on the internet. TikTok right now is full of content that's created by people all over the world. It doesn't even really matter where they're from, because we're looking mostly at the visuals, the slapstick comedy that comes with TikTok and visual presentations. Now let's move to the third factor that's causing globalization. These are what I call global media conglomerates. They used to be called transnational corporations, but transnational corporations are speaking to a company that has a core set of beliefs that happens to be operating in other countries. Like a Disney company used to have a core set of beliefs. It's a family programming. It's even part of our cultural tradition in the United States, Disney is. We expect Disney to raise our kids after they graduate from Sesame Street and PBS. When the parents are working, they say, okay, Disney's safe. But kids soon figure out that Disney is not presenting a realistic world, and then they turn to MTV or whatever they're going to turn to, YouTube, and they break away from Disney. That was the old method of organizing a country, where you have a core set of values, and whatever your product is, it's going to meet these core set of values. Not today. Global media conglomerates can own multiple media properties in multiple companies, and they can have several subdivisions of their companies or subsidiaries. And it doesn't matter what the product is in terms of meeting a core value system. What matters is whether that product is going to serve a target market. For example, the News Corporation in the United States, it's found a niche with conservative-oriented programming. The News Corporation, run by Rupert Murdoch's son, Rupert Murdoch, an Australian who emigrated to the United States and took out American citizenship just so that he could start the Fox Television Network, which is owned by the News Corporation. The News Corporation delivers a lot of conservative news. However, that same company, the News Corporation, owns a tabloid newspaper in Britain called The Sun, which is the most popular tabloid newspaper and regularly features topless women in the newspaper. That is not a publication that the News Corporation would offer here in the United States. And so the new company, the global media conglomerate, is really about finding niche markets overseas and developing subsidiaries to deliver product to those markets. And these companies, by the way, they're not just media companies. The Disney company is a great example of that. It has all these holdings in theme parks, which are, of course, tied in with its media product. The Mickey Mouses that you see in their costume when you go to Disney World, that's just reinforcing the brand of Mickey Mouse as a cartoon, as one of the main ways that we take in Disney. And so we've got the Disney Corporation I've mentioned. We've got the News Corporation. We've got this very strange company that's a combination of Viacom and CBS. A very strange history there, where CBS started Viacom as a TV production division, but it grew so fast that Viacom bought CBS at one point. It was referred to as the child buying the parent. But they've had a very unusual relationship, because they're separate companies, but they share a lot of the same personnel and a lot of the same people on the board of directors. Another big company. Then you've got NBC Universal, which is now Comcast, which prior to that was Vivendi, which is a water bottling company in France. And then it got bought and merged and converged. And it's really tough to keep track of all these. And Google owns YouTube. The largest media conglomerate in the world today is Google. Yeah, Google surpassed all the others. In terms of its overall revenue, Google has the most sprawling and biggest income-producing apparatus that any media conglomerate has. And there's another big one that you may not know about called the Bertelsmann Company. That's a German company, mostly founded on song publishing and books. It's a big media conglomerate in Europe. So the media conglomerate is a second reason, a second factor why globalization is taking place. Again, global media conglomerates are promiscuous. They're not satisfied with reaching a ceiling of an audience with their product. They're always searching to market their product to new audiences overseas. And then finally, as a factor, we have audience curiosity. I briefly mentioned that earlier. It's the idea that, you know, when you drink coffee for the first time, you don't like it. It's an acquired taste. And so it takes another time and then another time, and then can't give it up, right? Well, I can. I don't drink coffee. I drink tea. I guess you could say the same about tea. It's not exactly something you taste for the first time that you like. So that's what audience curiosity is about. We have to have it built up. Many of you might try the show Money Heist that I've mentioned three times in class now, and you might say, I can't handle these Spanish subtitles. I don't like reading while I'm watching television. Well, I forced myself to watch Money Heist with the Spanish titles because it actually highlights the dialogue much more, and the dialogue is really interesting to me in that show. And so what I'm talking about here is it does take a while to get used to new conventions in media. And audience curiosity can be stimulated, and then that's what drives people to seek out new shows. I'm going to be assigning a research paper in this class, and I know that there are going to be students in this class who are going to watch a show because they have to do a paper on it, and then they're going to be, you know what? I'm going to watch that whole series from Australia. I'm going to watch that whole series from Italy. I'm going to watch that whole telenovela soap opera from Brazil because I'm interested in it. Now my curiosity has been stimulated. Now, we've been talking about globalization off and on, but I think generally speaking, we would see it as a good thing. I think most people say, you know, it's fantastic that I can buy a shirt like this for $8. I got this shirt in Mexico, made in China. Yeah, even Mexico imports Chinese material. Isn't that a wonderful benefit? I can get my iPhone for whatever the discounted price is. Isn't that a wonderful benefit? Disregarding the people that are toiling, putting together the iPhone, the minerals that are being extracted from a very poor country of Congo. There's sort of a mixed bag, but overall we see globalization as good. But that's where media scholars come in. Media scholars point in that there are larger issues to consider here, and there are three main criticisms of globalization that I want to talk about now. Three main criticisms. One is the criticism of homogenization. Homogenization, can you figure out what that word is with the word homo in it? It means sameness, right? Homogenization is genre. So we've got a lot of sameness in programming out there. So if you watch any reality show, for example, it could be a Survivor, it could be a Big Brother, it could be The Bachelor or The Bachelorette, it could be Dancing with the Stars. There's a lot of sameness to those programs. You know, the contestants are eliminated one by one. There's a romance that is encouraged. There is conflict that is highlighted. There is suspense that is presented to you before they announce who's being eliminated next by cutting to a commercial before they come back and announce it. There's a lot of homogenization. Same goes true for music. If you put on a top 40 radio station and you drive across the United States, how many times are you going to hear a Lucas song? How many times are you going to hear a J-Lo song, a Nicki Minaj song? Newer artists, you can pick your own artists. How many times are you going to hear Kanye West? How many times are you going to hear, maybe not so much Kanye West because his radio material is not so arable, but there's a lot of sameness out there. There's a lot of sameness, which is homogenization. It results from corporations, despite the fact that they are promiscuous and seeking profit, they are very risk aversive. They're very risk aversive, especially in the realm of television. To have a TV show that is truly off the wall and different is very difficult in the United States because the big networks, when they produce shows, they want to roll out shows that are spin-offs of previous shows. How many shows do you know right now that are just copies of previous versions? Better Call Saul, for example, coming out of Breaking Bad. Once a formula becomes successful, then corporations are reluctant to leave that formula behind completely, and they roll out just different versions of it. So homogenization is one of the criticisms of globalization. And the homogenization can be seen when you travel around the world. You can go into the smallest village in Africa, and if it's got a movie theater, you're going to find a Hollywood movie playing there. So homogenization is one of the criticisms. A second criticism of globalization is what is known as unfairness in information flow. Unfairness in information flow. And if you look at the world and you try to see the information that's flowing around it, you'll see that it is uneven. It's uneven, first of all, in the direction of information flow. Like, when was the last time that you saw a reporter from Ecuador describing that country? When was the last time that you saw a person who is actually from Canada talking about Canada? It doesn't usually happen because the information is mostly one direction. It's flowing from the big Western countries, United States, into Canada, but it's not flowing out of Canada. It's flowing from the United States into Mexico, but it's not flowing out of Mexico. I'll ask you a very basic question. It's going to make you feel very silly. Okay, so the United States is surrounded by only two countries, Mexico and Canada. Only two countries. So since they are our only two neighbors, it makes perfect sense that you know who the leading elected politician is in each country. You know the names of the presidents. Only one position I'm asking you here, of Mexico. You know the president, the prime minister of Canada, right? You know their names, right? No, you don't, do you? Maybe you know that Justin Trudeau is the Canadian prime minister, and that's probably only because, this is a very demeaning comment I'm about to make, but it's true for some people, he has what is considered to be a good look about him, a good-looking guy. And so he's more visually appealing, so we'll be more inclined to let some of his material creep into our news reports, but by and large, you're not seeing much reporting on Canada. And Mexico, I would be surprised if a single person in this class knows it is Luis Obrador, who's the president of Mexico, and he's holding four-hour press conferences every morning. So we don't know this. The direction of the flow of information is one way. It's mostly out of Western, big, powerful, rich countries into smaller countries. And then also, the information flow can be unfair. If I was to ask you to write down the first three things that you think of when I mention Syria, for example, what would you write down? Would you write down war? Would you write down Russia? Would you write down terrorism? If I was to do the same for Cuba, would you write down communism? Would you write down outdated? Would you write down maybe beautiful? I don't know. But it's the idea that countries are not being represented for what they are. A country like Lebanon is perceived as a war-torn country, very tiny country in the Middle East. You're never going to imagine that you can go to the beaches during the day in Lebanon, and you can go to beautiful forests in the evening, and you can drive from one side of the country to the other. It's a very modern country, at least respective to other Middle Eastern countries. Misrepresented. In part, countries are misrepresented because when we report on them, we use our own American people to learn about Cuba, to learn about Mexico, to learn about all these other countries rather than listening to people from those countries. So there's an unfairness in the representation, all of which led to a big movement in the 1980s called the New World Information Order to try and restructure that by making recommendations that news organizations use reporters that are indigenous to those countries. CNN does that to some extent, but it's nowhere near what the people who constructed this new paradigm, a new way to structure the information, would go. It's like, have you ever had your reputation presented by somebody else and you don't like the way it's been presented? They've been gossiping about you, and that's the feeling at a country level. It's the feeling at a personal level that countries also have. And now it takes us to our third criticism of globalization. Our third criticism is called cultural imperialism. Cultural imperialism is borrowing from a past use of that term. Imperialism used to be where a country that had a lot of wealth and power and military might would invade another country. They would go into that other country and they would imperialize it. That's what happened under colonialization. If you go to Ghana today, the language of the country is not one of the indigenous tribal languages, and Ghana has many languages, including oral only languages, languages that there are no written form, therefore newspapers are not viable in certain parts of Ghana. But the language today, the primary language is English, and that's because of cultural imperialism. That's because the English forced their way into Ghana, part of the slave trade, and before that, part of the gold trade. Ghana used to be called the Gold Coast. And so now you have a country that has been imperialized. The new imperialism is more subtle. It has to do with media making its way into a country and then diluting the traditions that exist in that country. And worse than that, the young people growing up start to adopt the traditions that are represented in the media and they start to lose their old traditions. In France, for example, France is a country that eats very different from the United States. When you eat in France, you sit down in a restaurant and you wait forever for the waiter. And if you're an American, you're complaining about how terrible the service is. And that is because the French eat differently. They don't perceive that you're in a rush. Their job isn't to move and turn over the tables as quickly as possible so that they can maximize tips. No, the French meal, you're supposed to sit, you're supposed to talk. It's an evening of relaxation. Your body needs to be relaxed when you ingest that food. And that's why you have three courses or four courses of food. You've got your appetizer, then your entree, and then you have a dessert that doesn't always consist of the big piece of chocolate cake or pie or ice cream or banana split or whatever it is. It's often cheese and grapes. And then that's followed by a drink, often in France called a digestive, which is an alcohol with a fruit inside of it, like a pear. And that is designed to break up that food which has been ingested into the body with a very, very relaxed stomach. You're not eating on the go. You're not eating fast. You're not eating with your stomach tight because you need to get this done so you can type up a paper for class or get to work. That's the American style. The American style is using our cup holder in our car perfectly to fit a burrito into while we're driving. Yeah, that's not what France wants, and yet that's what France faces with the influx of fast food commercials. McDonald's, Burger King, Wendy's. Yeah, you can see them all in France. And so it's an example of cultural imperialism. If people in France start to adopt that way of eating and are the fast way of eating and are doing away with a tradition of French eating, which is part of the culture. And you can see that all over the world as traditions are going away. A tradition like Day of the Dead in Mexico to celebrate ancestors, where Mexicans actually bring out food and put it on the table as a nod to their ancestors. That's being, in a way, taken over by Halloween. Halloween being exported in movies like Halloween and just news reports and American culture in general being interested in by the rest of the world. When does the Day of the Dead cease to become the Day of the Dead and become Halloween? That's what we're talking about here. We're talking about it sneaking in the back door. Cultural imperialism and diluting your own culture. So the question really becomes, is a culture strong enough to resist that? Some cultures perceive that they're not, and they actually have quotas on the amount of imported media that can come in. Canada has quotas on the amount of English-speaking media that can come into its country, making sure that X percentage of radio.